All right, guys, this is note card 66. It is called the mean value theorem for integrals. Now, before we jump into this note card, let's review real quick what the mean value theorem was as it related to rates of change or derivatives. So let's think about what the mean value theorem said. All right, so let's call this curve f of x. So what did the mean value theorem say, or the MVT? All right, what it said is that if you have some function, if you had some function f of x, and that function was continuous and differentiable, it's got to be both, okay? And if I drew a secant line between these two points, okay, this secant line, that's the secant line. Okay, what the mean value theorem says is that the slope of this secant line is going to equal the same slope as some tangent line. Okay, so those two lines would in effect be parallel to each other. Okay, so if you have some function that's continuous and differentiable, all right, there's some value c in between a and b where the slope of the secant line connecting points A and B, okay, is the same as the slope of the tangent line. Okay, so notationally, the slope of the tangent line, it's an instantaneous rate of change, so we would call that f prime of c, and that's going to equal the slope of the secant line. Now, how do we figure out what the secant line is? Well, any type of slope of a line that would be considered f of b, this point right here would be considered f of a. This right here, that difference is the change in y. Okay, this right here is the change in x. So that would be change in y over change in x, which would simply be f of b minus f of a all over b minus a. Okay, so that's what the mean value theorem says. And again, the two conditions is that f has to be continuous and differentiable. It's going to be continuous on the closed interval and differentiable on the open interval. So that's the mean value theorem as it relates to rates of change. Now, this note card is talking about a different type of mean value theorem. So let me try to illustrate what the mean value theorem for integrals means. Here's what it means graphically. Okay, here's what it means graphically. If you have some curve, and it can be any type of curve, okay, and the only condition is that f has to be continuous. It doesn't even have to be differentiable. Okay, it just has to be continuous. All right. Right, here's what it says. It says that if I have some definite integral, okay, or if I have some area underneath the curve, between the curve and the x-axis, there's some value in between, okay, it might be further to the right, it might be further to the left, but the general idea is there's some value c in between a and b, such that, okay, if I take C up to where it hits the curve, I take C up to where it hits the curve. The area of this green box, or this green rectangle, is exactly the same as the area of the definite integral. It would be exactly the same as the area there. Okay, so what it's saying is the area of the green rectangle is equal to the area of the area between the curve and the x-axis from A to B. So let's think about what that the area of that green box really means. Well, if it's a rectangle, it has a certain width. It has a certain width. All right. And that width would be nothing more than B minus A. Okay. Times the height. Well, there's the height. It's the same thing as f of c. That would be the height. Okay. So if we wanted to find this height, if I wanted to solve for that height, okay, I could simply divide both sides of this by b minus a. So to find that height, all I have to do is take the definite integral divided by the width. Okay. And if you think about why this works in terms of a rectangle, think about the area of a rectangle, it's base times height. Okay. Or let's think about it another way. Let's think about it as width times height. Okay. If I want to solve this for height, I just divide by width. Okay. So the height equals the area divided by the width. Area, okay. Green or black here, there's the area divided by the width, which is nothing more than the difference of B and A. That's what this is saying. Here's the area piece. So height, f of c is height. That part is area divided by width. That's what it represents. And that is exactly what this is saying. Okay. They're just pulling, instead of writing the, this equals the same thing as a to b f of x dx over b minus a. They're just pulling that coefficient out front. There's really an understood one in front of that integral. This part's not in the integral, so it's part of the coefficient, so they can pull that out. Okay, so what they're saying is area divided by the width equals the height. So let's try a couple example problems here. And there's not much to this note card. So it says, using the mean value theorem for integrals, find the value of c. Okay. So if I were to graph this function, I'm going to do it graphically as well, just so you can see it. All right. So if I start at 1, if I plug in 1 here, 1 squared is 4. Or 4 over 1 squared is 4 over 1, which is 4. And now if I go up to 4 here, if I plug in 4, 4 squared is 16, and 4 over 16 would be a fourth. Okay, so that's only a fourth I. And so this curve looks something like this. Okay. All right. So what they're asking me to find, okay, they're asking me to find where on this curve do I have a C such that if I were to take C up to where it hits the curve, Where would the area of that green rectangle I'm drawing in be the same as the area of that between the curve and the x-axis, the black part? So this is what we're going to do. Okay, we're going to start by saying f of c equals, the height equals the area between 1 and 4, of that curve over the difference between 4 and 1, these boundaries. So if we want to simplify this a little bit, so basically that's going to tell me what this f of c is. If we were to take that across, it's going to tell me the height. All right. So how can we simplify the top? We can use the fundamental theorem of calculus. Okay, so I can rewrite that as 4x to the negative 2 dx, and I can rewrite the denominator. 4 minus 1 is simply 3. Now, if we take the antiderivative of this, the 4 would come outside the integral. Okay, we would make the power go up by 1 and divide by negative 1. And then we would evaluate it between 1 and 4, and then we divide all that by 3. Okay, so let's keep rewriting. 4 divided by negative 1 is negative 4. X to the negative 1 is the same thing as saying over x. 1 to 4, all divided by 3. Now we plug in the upper boundary. So negative 4 over 4, I'm plugging that 4 in there for x. Okay, minus negative 4 over 1, all divided by 3. All right, negative 4 over 4 is negative 1. Here we have a negative negative, so I can think about those as just being positive. So 4 over 1 is just 4. Negative 1 plus 4 is 3. And 3 over 3 would just be 1. So I figured out that the height of the rectangle is really 1. Okay. The height is really 1. So I didn't draw this very well. Okay. The height should actually be about right there. Okay. The height's really right there. But it's not asking me to find the height. Now they're actually asking me to find c. Okay. Well, here I have the function. So where does the function equal 1? Okay. So since the function equaled 1, or the height equaled 1, let's figure out what x value makes that work. So 4 over x squared. So we just have to solve that equation now. If we cross multiply, we get x squared equals 4. Take the square root of both sides, x equals plus or minus 2. Now, one of these answers doesn't make sense because negative 2 is not in this interval. It's not between 1 and 4. So I can eliminate the negative part of that answer. Okay, so simply the c value is 2 because this c value, if I plug in 2 here, 2 squared. Okay, 2 squared is 4, and 4 over 4 is 1. So when that's 2, it's going to hit the curve at 1. So that's the right answer. When the x value is 2, the y value is 1. Okay, so the area of this rectangle, if you want to think about it, okay, you go 3 units long, 1 unit high, the area of that is 3. What did we say the area underneath the curve in the x-axis was? It was 3, so they match up. The area of that rectangle is the same as the area under the curve. And that happens at an x value of 2. Right. Let's look at another example here. All right, cosine of x. We should know what cosine of x looks like. Between negative pi over 3, which means negative 60 degrees, and positive pi over 3, positive 60 degrees. Okay, well, cosine of 0 would just be 1. All right. And if I go out to 60 degrees, or pi over 3 radians, the cosine of 60 degrees, okay, you can use your hand here, your hand trick, pull back to 60, got one finger there, so it's 1/2. And negative pi over 3 is negative 60. You're in the fourth quadrant. Okay, if you're in the fourth quadrant, cosine's still positive. So your curve kind of looks something like this. So we want to figure out where, and there can be more than one answer here. Where can I put a C? Okay, where could I possibly maybe put a C? That if I take that C up and draw it across, the area of that basically black rectangle becomes the same as the area underneath the curve. That's what I'm really asked to find. Okay, and we have to use calculus to help us find that. Okay, so basically, f of c is going to equal the area between negative pi over 3 to pi over 3 cosine of x over the width of this. Well, just think about the width here, it's not that hard. You go pi thirds in that direction, you go pi thirds in this direction. So in total, and it's just going to be 2 pi over 3. Just going to be 2 pi over 3. And again, we're finding the height first. This thing represents the height of that rectangle. So the antiderivative of cosine is simply sine because the derivative of sine is cosine. And I'm going to evaluate that from pi third, negative pi thirds to pi thirds. And then after I do that, I'm going to divide by 2 pi over 3. Okay, so let's go ahead and do that. All right, so I would do the sine of pi thirds minus the sine of negative pi thirds all over 2 pi over 3. Okay, well, what's the sine of pi thirds? What's the sine of 60? Hopefully you say that's radical 3 over 2. What about negative 60 in your fourth quadrant? That's negative root 3 over 2 all over 2 pi thirds. So two negatives here make a positive. So one radical 3 over 2 plus another one radical 3 over 2 becomes two radical 3 over 2 divided by 2 pi thirds. Well, these twos knock each other out. To make this a little bit nicer, dividing by 2 pi over 3 is the same as multiplying by the reciprocal. So I'd have root 3 times 3 over 2 pi. Or a nicer way to say this is f of c equals 3 radical 3 over 2 pi. 3 radical 3 over 2 pi. But that's the height. That's equal to the height. And if you want to know what that is as a decimal, if I plug this into my calculator, let's see what that gives us. Okay. About 0.826 or 827 if you round. So how are we going to figure out what x value? And again, like I said, it can be more than just one. So if we plug that in, 3 radical, let me do it in a different color. That's the y value, 3 radical 3 over 2 pi equals the cosine of x. How are we going to solve that? Okay, the only way you're really going to solve this is with a calculator. The only way you're really going to solve this is with a calculator. So if I just plot the cosine of x, and I only want to be looking between negative pi thirds to pi thirds, Let's just do a zoom fit. It should look similar to the graph I drew. Okay, fair enough. Now we're going to draw another line. We're going to draw that y value, which is 3 radical 3 all over 2 pi. As you can see, there's two values. Okay. There's that value and there's this value. How are you going to figure out the x value? You're going to do an intersect calculation. So go to number 5. Okay. It's asking me first curve. So I'm on the parabola. Get close to the intersection. Second curve, get close to the intersection. Guess, just hit enter again. Okay. So negative 0.597, so that's one value that C works. Negative 0.597, okay. And just looking at it, the other one's probably gonna be the positive 0.597 because this graph has symmetry. But if we just go to calculate again, intersect, first curve, be on the parabola, just get close to the intersection here. Hit enter, second curve enter, guess enter again, positive 0.597. Okay, and this is the y value. So there's two answers that make it work. When that's the x value, 0.597, all right, maybe that's 0.597, maybe that's negative 0.597. You take it up to where it hits the curve, okay, and the area of that red box will be the same as the area under the curve. Or you could take it up from positive 0.597 to where it hits the curve, and the same thing applies. And they're asking for the x value though. Okay. They're asking for the x value. Okay. So let's look at some problems from the packet. Okay. Now this is packet 66. All right. So let's do this one. On this packet, there's a free response question, and there's some practice problems back here for you guys to work on. All right, the back is just more of a review of stuff we've already done. This has to do with some mean value theorem for integrals here, so along with some other review. It says the number of gallons P of T of a pollutant in a lake changes at the rate of this gallons per day. So if I want to think about P prime of T, okay, if I want to think about P prime of T, okay, that's gallons per day, okay, and this is days. Okay. If I just thought about the graph of P of T, okay, the units on that would just be gallons on that axis and days on this axis, so that might help us out. It says there are 50 gallons of the pollutant in the lake at time t equals zero. So since it's talking about gallons here, they know I'm giving you some sort of initial condition. So P of zero equals 50 gallons. It says the lake is considered to be safe when it contains 40 gallons or less of pollutants. Okay. Part A. And this is a calculator question too. All right. Part A. Is the amount of pollutant increasing at time t equals 9? Okay. Well, what does increasing mean? So if the pollutant is increasing, what should that mean about the derivative? Okay. That means the derivative should be positive. If the amount of pollutant is decreasing, then the derivative would be less than zero. Okay. So let's go ahead and put P prime into our calculator here because they gave us the equation for it. They told me that P prime of T was 1 minus 3E, all right, to the negative 0.2 radical t, but I have to use x. And basically x is like time, so I'm gonna start my time at 0. And I mean, we can go out to maybe like 10 days just to start. Actually, let's go out 30 days. And let's just do a zoom fit. All right, so there's actually the graph of p prime of t. So that's not a good graph. I just wanted to do these graphs to get our units right. Okay, anyway, if I hit trace, now it's asking me about at time t equals 9, at 9 days. So let's figure out what p prime of 9 is. Okay, so this is my graph of p prime. All I have to do is type 9, hit enter, and it's going to give me the value of p prime. That's the value of p prime right there. Negative 0.646. Okay, now we should put units on this. We already know about the units of p prime of t. It's in gallons per day. Okay, so at exactly 9 days, the amount of pollutant is decreasing at 0.646. Okay, so we would say at 9 days, amount of pollutant is decreasing because p prime of 9 is less than 0. Okay. Not a hard concept there. Right. So part B, it says, for what value of t will the number of gallons of pollutant be at its minimum? So we want the absolute minimum of pollutant. In other words, we want the absolute minimum or the smallest y value of p of t. All right. So let's look back at this real quick. Maybe I go above 30 days. Maybe we go to, 100 days and zoom fit it. Okay, it crosses the x-axis somewhere, which is good. Okay. So if I were to do a number line analysis, okay, and technically we can't get smaller than 0 days, that's when we start our time. All right, let's find the zero of this p prime. So, second calculate the zero. All right, it's asking me for a left bound, so I choose a point on the curve that's to the left of where it crosses. It's asking for a right bound, I just choose a point to the right of where it crosses. Now it says guess, I'm gonna choose the one that looks the closest, hit enter, okay. So it looks like 30.173. What do you notice about the sine of p prime? The sine of p prime to the left of there, it's below the axis, so p prime is negative. Okay, and to the right of there, it's positive. And so what does that mean about p of t? That means P of T would be decreasing, the amount of pollutant would be decreasing to the left and increasing to the right. Well, this is a relative minimum because it's making this shape, all right? So the amount of pollutant is at a minimum at t equals 30.173 days, and I have to justify, because p prime of t changes from negative to positive, indicating a relative minimum. All right. So part C, is the lake safe when the number of gallons of pollutant is at its minimum? So I want to find the amount of pollutant at 30.173 days. That's what I need to figure out. And once I figure it out, if this number is below 40, then we're good. So how am I going to figure that out? Okay, that's the big question. Well, we know what P of 0 was. That was given in the problem. All right, it starts with 50 gallons of pollutant in the lake. All right. So let's think about what this means. If I were to take the area between 0 and 30.173 of P prime of T, we know from the fundamental theorem of calculus that that's going to be the same thing as P of 30.173 minus P of 0. Now, if we manipulate this equation, we can solve for this. Okay, so to be able to solve for that, I can add P of 0 to both sides. The initial amount of pollutant plus how much pollutant got removed, and that's what this thing means. Okay. That's going to equal P of 30.173. Well, what was P of 0? It was 50 plus, okay, since we're already on the graph here, okay, let's go ahead. When I did the calculate, it kept this number in here. So if I just hit the STO button, oops, sorry, let's go back into the graph. So second, calculate the 0. All right, left bound, right bound, guess. Yeah, there's the 30.173 again. Quit out of there and then hit store. Hit the STO button. That's the button down here, STO. Okay, let's just store that as, you can store it for whatever you want. Store it as T, for instance. I hit alpha and then I hit the number 4. It's going to store that last number. So I get all the decimal places after it. So how can I figure that out? Okay. I can simply go math 9. I can go between 0 and that exact decimal, which I call t. Well, where's P prime? It's already in Y1 for us. So I can use my shortcut and go Y1 with respect to X. Hit enter. That's negative 14.896. You want to think about why? Let's look back at the graph. Because the derivative is negative, which means the amount of pollutant is going down. If I were to add up this area between the curve and the x-axis, this is how much pollutant is getting removed since it's negative. All right, so I can do the same thing here. If I went into the graph and hit number 7, it says lower limit. I could say 0, upper limit. That was that t I already stored. That's going to do the shading for me here. Okay, and I'm going to get the same number, negative 14.896. So now let's just add those two numbers. So 50 minus 14.896. All right, that's 35.104 gallons. That's what the minimum pollutant level is in the lake. So is it safe? Yes, safe because it's under, or I should say, never say it's safe because the amount of pollutant at this time is less than 40. And the last question here, it says, an investigator uses the tangent line approximation to P of t at t equals zero as a model for the amount of pollutant in the lake. At what time t does this model predict that the lake becomes safe? Okay. Well, what would the slope of the tangent line be? What would the slope of the tangent line be? So this is, I'm going to kind of do part D along the side here. The slope of the tangent line. Well, actually, let's just kind of start more general. What would be the equation of the tangent line? To find the equation of the tangent line, we need two things. We need a point and we need a slope. So the point they gave me, the tangent line to the graph of P here, well, the point, the t value is 0, and we already know what the p there is, it's 50. And how are we going to find the slope? Well, that's going to be p prime at 0. Now, is there a way to find that? There sure is. Okay. So, if I just hit trace, remember, this is the p prime. If I just type in 0, p prime of 0 is negative 2. Okay, it's negative 2. Okay. Just think about why. Okay, look up here at this equation. You didn't even have to go back to the graph if you really don't want to. All right, there's my t. Square root of 0 is 0. Times that, still 0. E to the 0 is 1. 1 minus 3 times 1 is negative 2. Okay. So that's why you really didn't have to use the graph. Okay, so the equation of my tangent line here would be y minus 50 equals negative 2x minus 0. Okay. So that would be the equation of the tangent line. It's saying use this as a model for P. It says, at what time t does this model predict that the lake becomes safe? Okay, well, the lake's going to be safe when it's 40 or below. Okay, so the y value would be 40. So I can plug in 40 there. X minus nothing is still x. All right, 40 minus 50 is negative 10. So if I divide through by negative 2 there, it's going to give me 5. So this model predicted that it's safe at 5 days, okay, which is a big difference between when it's at its minimum. Okay. So it predicted, the model predicted that the lake would be safe at 5. And just as kind of, let's see what the actual would have been if I would have gone second, calculate number 7, 0 to 5. And I took that area. That area is only negative 6.196. So if it started at 50 and we removed this much pollutant, we'd actually have about a little less than 44 gallons. Okay. That's why this is just an estimate. Okay, and that's just an estimate. Okay. So, kind of a hard question, especially I think part C and D were the hardest parts of this. A and B, not too bad. C, you just gotta know what you're doing. Okay, you gotta know what you're doing. But if you get B right, you're much more likely to get C right. And if you understand what they're asking for in part D, it's really not too bad. Okay, so that's how you would approach that free response question. It is a calculator question. Hopefully you can see that it's kind of difficult. They give you a hard function. Why do they give you a hard function? Because they let you use your calculator. Okay. So on the back, just practice. There's a lot of U sub that you can do in there. to make things a little bit easier on yourself. Okay, real quick, let's just look on some of these that are fairly straightforward. All right. So, all right. I know this one's kind of hard to read, but up in that E, it just says x squared plus 2x. Let that be your U. And my advice on this one, factor the numerator, it might cancel the whole denominator. This one we've done before, draw that absolute value and actually find the area geometrically. All right, this one, best thing to do is do a U sub right there. All right, you have a logic question. All right, this is purely the definition of fundamental theorem of calculus. Purely. All right. They're telling you to make a certain U sub and simplify. Don't forget, when you make a U sub, you got to change those boundaries into U world. All right. Think about what this means. Okay. Maybe break it up into pieces. Right. Think about what this graph looks like. That might help a little bit. Or plug it in, draw the graph. Okay. Maybe this one, you might want to, separate that out into two terms. It becomes much, much easier. Becomes much, much easier. So there's some hints for the back of that. Not too bad. Hopefully the video helped you out.